Good evening, everyone, and welcome to day two of the second leg of the three-day panels under the umbrella of allyship. The big umbrella of the three panels is intersectionality. And today we are looking into performative allyship versus true allyship and trying to dig in what is allyship. Is allyship even a thing? Like, these are the questions that we can negotiate together. But before we get into that, I would like to read to you the rules of engagement of the space so that we all have an understanding of what kind of space it is that we're engaged in. And so these are the rules. We are all responsible for the space. We welcome multiple viewpoints. Speak for yourself. Don't speak for others. Practice recognizing your privileges. Appreciate the different experiences and abilities of others. Take responsibility for the power of your language. Be open to dialogue. Take risks. Lean into the discomfort. Step back. Share speaking time. Listen actively before thinking about how to respond. Challenge with care. Respect confidential information when sharing with others. Try to be as clear as you can. Respect your boundaries and those of others. Acknowledge the source of your thoughts and do not appropriate, appreciate. So, without all further ado, welcome to these lovely panelists that we have. It's a very POC panel, and it's nice. It's and I think it's the perfect panel to talk about allyship, and especially within the POC context, which I think this is where the conversation will gravitate towards, because we will also share, I think everybody will come from a point of view of experience, more than anything. And my name is Dudu Zilelibazi Sasfiso Matunsi. I am a performing artist, a writer, a former journalist, and many more other things. And I've asked that the guests introduce themselves, so we do not have a reading of a whole lot of academic things. I think in order for this conversation to be meaningful, I have asked them to come as they are and introduce themselves of how they would want to be viewed. So, without any further ado, Sheba, shall we start with you?
Yes, we can start. My name is Sheba Biafa. I am a political educator, which means I do workshops around anti-racism, racism, anti-blackness especially, and do empowerment spaces as well. I would say I mostly work in community spaces, organizing, and then as well, I'm a political science student in a master's degree, so I also try to have conversation and discuss theoretical things as well, on a theoretical level. I think that's a little bit enough to understand where I'm about, yeah.
Thank you. Sama?
Hi, everybody. My name is Zamali Samdota. I am first and foremost an angry black woman. I'm a storyteller off screen and stage. I do a lot of decolonial work in the digital media space. And I'm just so happy to be here.
Hey, everybody. My name is Ajayini Satyan, and I study gender and diversity. I'm also an educator like Sheba. I do workshops. I also conduct lectures as well, mostly dealing with intersectionality of race, culture, ethnicity, gender. Apart from that, I do political, a little bit of passive political activism through my work, education work, and also I make art, and sometimes I'm on stage reading my very sad and angry poems. Yeah, that's me.
And thank you guys. Thank you so much. This is going to be fun. And thank you for those who are watching. We have an audience. And thank you for taking your time to come and see us and be with us as we address some of these topics. Without any further ado, I want to get into the first question, which is the big umbrella of the festival is intersectionality and these different meeting points, which I always find so interesting, and like sharing experiences, but also holding spaces for each other. And I wanted to know individually from each and one of you, like, what is your take, or what do you think, in your opinion, or how, what is intersectionality to you? I'm going to start with you, Ajini.
Intersectionality is black and white and gray at the same time. It's just stapling of different aspects of a person's life. For example, something that could be very negative is being a person of color, being disabled, being queer, and being poor, and lacking living space. So this is like a basic idea of intersectionality at the most terrible. One of the most terrible conditions. And you can be a person of color, but being born in a Western country, have access to have a social status and protected status, and then have the knowledge of language, and still be discriminated for being a BIPOC person. And that's kind of in a gray area, because it depends on the perspective. Either you can see it as a bad, or you know, it stays in the gray zone. And then there is this super white region. I'm speaking from a very conventional standard where everything white is, everything white and pure and light is seen as good, and everything dark is seen as bad. So I'm kind of trying to bring a philosophical aspect to it too. Being a cis white man, Christian, with lots of money, then you're intersectional still. It's an intersectional aspect, but a very beneficial aspect. So it is very much white, black, and gray. So it kind of is in this spectrum of, I see it that way.
Thank you for that. Zama, what is intersectionality to you?
I think intersectionality, I firstly have to mention its core, which is Kimberly Williams Crenshaw, who's the leading academic on critical race theory. And she created it to basically explain the cumulative experience so that we are not using identities as check boxes like black or queer or woman. It is me being black and me being a woman is not something, I cannot choose between both. I'm a black woman, and that intersection that I sit and live at affects my experience different to say a black man or a white woman. And intersectionality is the understanding of who gets to be protected in terms of the cis white male with money, and who is not, according to the cumulative experiences of identities that are marginalized. And for me, that's what intersectionality sits as in my body.
I can definitely relate with both of your answers. I feel like the first time I learned about intersectionality was when I learned to understand my experience. And one of my teachers taught me then that the experiences that you make as a black woman is one of an intersectionality. And that's where I think my process of understanding my life reality, but also of those of others, where experience of discrimination come together and you can't separate them, made me understand those life realities. And I did listen to the panel yesterday, and I heard that one person talked about intersectionality as a tool. And I know that especially in Germany, we tend to talk about intersectionality as an approach, a tool. But in a conversation that I had a few weeks back, I was so shook, because I came back to the point that I initially learned, is that intersectionality is life experience. And you can't approach something with life experience. What you need to do, you make them open for intersectional people to enter those spaces. Mm. But talking about it as a tool, talking about it as an approach, and just reduce it is also makes the people that are living intersectionalities very invisible.
Mm. Yes. Mm. I feel. Can I quickly?
Yes,
say something?
Continue.
I feel that intersectionality, as they said, it is in a way a tool which is used, which is not supposed to be. It's not supposed to be a tool, but is used to kind of direct recognition for certain people, or try to make certain bodies or lives visible and others not that visible. Yeah.
Can I also add to that? In what you're saying there, I think in the approach to try and make more perhaps invisible identities more visible, we've placed ourselves in this nature of treating our identities like checkboxes. And what that also does is perhaps highlight our differences instead of acknowledging our differences, in a sense. Because when I'm highlighting that I'm this compared to your this and this, suddenly we're playing oppression Olympics. And the thing about oppression Olympics is that nobody wins. I wanted to add to that.
Well, I mean, speaking of tools, I think this is a good way to enter the overall conversation of today, which is performative allyship versus true allyship. And you know, like I sat with these questions, like when I created the question board, I was in a different space, and I was like, you know, everything's performative, even in the attempts of doing good. For me, it's like performative allyship kind of falls into the box of the good people, like goodness in a way. And then that for me is always, I always think of this, the road to hell within Christianity says the road to hell is led by good intentions, right? So that kind of like duality of like, we're good people, we're doing good things, I think also has a tendency to not allow whiteness or any other person who's not within a marginalized group to see their biases, because they're recycling, they're doing good, they're kind sometimes, but not really looking at the core of their biases. So as we get into it, like for me, it was also a question of thinking of like, can true allyship actually even exist? Like that is, it is again coming back into the questions of the festival and this utopia, right? Because true allyship would play back into the utopia. And we all know that utopia is so far-fetched for us as POCs sitting here. Utopia is at a further reach than whiteness. So with that, I wanted to ask, like, I wanted to ask you guys, what is the difference between performative allyship and true allyship? But I don't think that's a question I want to ask anymore, because then it's, what I just said makes that question redundant in a way. So rather is, do we think that we can ever achieve true allyship? Can we reach it? Can we reach some form, or not us, can it be reached by others? Even us as well, because we are, as a cis black woman, I have alliances that I have to be part of. And for me, allyship is a muscle. It's a muscle that's worked. Like every single day, when you decide that you want to have the fittest body, you wake up, you go to gym, and you make your six pack, which I have zero commitment with that too. So that same muscle that you need to exercise is allyship. You will fail, you will come back up again, and you will keep trying, but it's a forever thing, because our reality is forever as well. So coming back to it, do you think it can be achieved by allies, true allyship? Anyone can start.
Okay. I don't know. I can't see your faces, so I'm going to quickly give a definition of what performative allyship is and what true allyship. So true allyship is when you're mowing your own lawn. If you're going to mow your own lawn, keep everything trim and nice, then it's true allyship, just to give an example. Performative allyship is that you're mowing your lawn as a... not your neighbor, but neighbor's lawn, and then you are this 5-year-old who's expecting for expecting money or cookies or ice cream. You know, that's you. If you go with expectations and do some work, it's self-serving and you're not doing any good for you or for others, and that's performative allyship. That's it. That to achieve true allyship is definitely a challenge. I mean, it comes from a very personal space as a privileged person. Because you're so privileged, why do you want to change things? If everything functions for you, you're not going to get bashed, beaten, spit on, grabbed at, groped. Not just because you're just ugly and boring, but, you know, apart from that, you're just so privileged. It's just that, you know, yeah, I mean, why you want to change it? And if you're still going to do that, it's because there's some personal push to do that. Either it's your child, it's your partner, it's your family, it's your friend. You know, I feel that a true allyship comes from a very personal space where someone close to you, someone you really care for and love, is affected, and you're pushed. If you're someone who doesn't have anyone, your circle, your whole circle is like white as fuck or whatever you're gonna say it, and still you're doing it, people are definitely questioning what's wrong with you. I mean, like, I will definitely wonder what's wrong with you, but, you know, if you're doing it, then it's interesting. Then I need to study those people to see exactly what is going on. But from my experience, I've noticed there has to be some personal push to be a true ally without expecting any gold star, any cookie, any ice cream, any money, nothing, no appreciation, no pat on the back. You're just going to do the hard work. Deal with the grime, deal with the dirt, deal with the insults and still do it, then you're a true ally. As simple as that.
I think it is, it's very interesting when you say that it's very personal. But I also do know that there are people who are trying to be an ally outside of their own personal. And of course they're far and in between, right? But I think it's like, some of them, I think, question if I'm an ally for one thing, then why can't I be an ally for the other thing? Because somehow we have, there's also ally Olympics that we're in, right? Where people determine which allyship is the truer cause, right? And so within these Olympics, we get lost in terms of like which is more important, rather than I feel like true allyship should spread out to every cause. I have my own biases. I have my own privileges. I am a privileged Black woman. I have had a good life. And I move around circles where I am privileged, but I also have that duality of intersectionality. And within my privilege, and if I'm fighting for the cause as a Black woman, actually, when I think of the chain of thought, I'm thinking like, maybe those who are practicing true allyship are a lot of the times people who are already of segregated backgrounds, because they understand what that feels. But when you don't have that kind of discomfort, I think you move in the world a little differently in terms of even wanting to be an ally, period, you know? But Zama, what's your take on this?
I actually want to jump on the mowing your own lawn, because I think that's a beautiful metaphor. Because it's about self-awareness. Because when you're aligning yourself with someone, you have to be aware of the fight in which you are helping to fight. So there has to be an awareness in, say, white supremacy, that there are people who are suffering under white supremacy. And me, as perhaps as a white person, white cis, or white queer, am understanding that I have to, if I call myself an ally to someone suffering under white supremacy, I'm understanding that I have to, first of all, see if there is any role that I am playing in terms of perpetuating white supremacy and perpetuating the pain and that it causes is on everyone, even white people, you know, are affected by white supremacy. It's understanding what we're fighting for, the place that, as an ally, I play, and what I can do to not perpetuate. And then it's that understanding of people who are suffering more than me. How can I be there for them? How can I, with my privileges, give them the space that the system will not give them? So it's performative allyship being when Trump won, people on social media saying, I'm gonna wear a safety pin so you know that I'm a good white. You know, I'm not a white that voted for Trump. Versus true allyship, which is a Black Lives Matter rally where white people stand in a line in front of people of color because they understand that the cops value white bodies more than bodies of color. So it is that understanding of the place that you play in the system, how you cannot perpetuate it, and how you can help move towards a place where it is dismantled while also protecting those who are most affected by it. That's what I think it is.
It's being able to, it comes back to yesterday's conversation when we talked about language and maybe like, if we can reach a point where we can have a common language of one sort. And for me, it comes back to there has to be a sacrifice. There has to be a sacrifice somewhere within your comfort. You have to be willing to sacrifice something. Because in the epitome of comfort, there's no destabilization. You know, like if you sit on a couch and you are having potato chips and ordering McDonald's, and you don't have to worry about gaining weight or being sick, you're just gonna do it. And then your life's just gonna carry on. But like, if somebody scares you and says, oh my gosh, you're gonna get diabetes or something like that, then you get up, right? So it's like, if there's no giving of yourself for the cause, then you can't participate in trying to be an ally. Shiba, I would like to hear from you.
I'm not sure if I can contribute so much to this conversation because a lot has already been said and I can agree with it, especially what you said was very beautiful. I did have a thought when you just spoke about Allyship Olympics, that I remember a situation, was it this or even, it was this summer, but it was also last summer when there were more demonstrations and people were talking about, okay, why aren't you coming to our demonstration? Why? And like, the Black Lives Matter demonstration here in Hamburg was huge. Like, I think one of the biggest like demonstration in a long time where people came on the streets. And then afterwards, a lot of the people said, okay, but why aren't you coming to the same fights that we are fighting? And these Allyship Olympics, they were happening. That's why I thought it was very interesting, Europe, because I hadn't heard that before. But I do think that when it comes to allyship, it comes down to not perpetuating those white supremacist structures that are already there and not reinforcing it. And that means you have to continuously question your behavior and where it comes from and unlearning the bias and decolonize. And that's a continuous work. And even for me, when I think about my role and how I can be an ally, I realize that it's a journey, it's a process, and it's a journey that I can never say, okay, I've reached the, or there's not a button that you can earn saying, okay, you're an ally. And that's why I would question every person that says I'm an ally to that cause. I mean, like, really? First of all, why are you saying it? And also, I just need to see them actions. And then I can decide whether or not you are to one of the specific causes an ally. But still, I think it's not something that can be reached in the sense of, okay, you're done, but rather something you do, just like, don't you say it with love as well? Love is a doing word. That's what I see with ally. You can't just say you're an ally.
Which is similar to like, you're going into the next phase of this conversation, which is trending allyship, right? And you, what a lot of the times happen is that when there's a movement, there's a cause that's big enough, people jump on the bandwagon, tag themselves, and then it actually gives them a monetary value, right? So constantly we're building, whiteness builds itself off the backs of Black and brown people or Asian. And it's this constant thing that is repetitive time and time again. For me, the Black Lives Matter was, I rolled my eyes, honestly, because I was like, it took a man to die in front of a camera and all of you to feel his soul get out of his body for you to believe hundreds of years of the same shit that we've been saying time and time and time and time, time again. And even within that, people still found a way to monetize, to capitalize, to gain. And that for me is the biggest disturbances within whiteness. It's disturbing to a point where, yeah, I don't know. For me, I think I'm slowly becoming a cynic on some kind of way.
Absolutely. Absolutely. As someone who is constantly on Twitter, I'm absolutely shaken when I watch, let's say, big tech and just big conglomerates absolutely profit off of the rage of marginalized people. And especially with George Floyd, it taking a man dying on camera for people to suddenly feel the need to show up was also made me just a little bit more cynical, because it also plays into the fact that violence against black bodies is so normalized that it had to get to that point, that people had to see that. But then we're also living in a time where police shootings and dead black bodies are part of the news cycle every day, to the point where black people have to be like, please do not share dead black bodies on social media. That is traumatizing to like everyone who, you know, has a heart. So I feel in that sense the trending of it, especially with that Black Tuesday and people doing the black squares on Instagram after George Floyd. And now every conglomerate is jumping on saying we have a commitment to black lives. We're, you know, going to look at our own corporations, see what we're doing wrong. But a year later, where are we? You know, that's performative. And that's where trending, you know, the trendiness of a movement for lives just feels redundant. Because it's just like a news cycle. In 24 hours, the next hot thing is going to come up, and suddenly black lives won't matter tomorrow, suddenly. So it's not about this entire movement being trending. It's about, say, looking towards the utopia and understanding that we cannot just arrive there. There is a lot of work, and there's a lot that people, like you said, people with privilege have to give up. It's because it's not just a trending topic. It's not as easy as putting a block and saying, okay, the work is done. No, you're playing into the very system, because white capitalist supremacy knows how to jump onto the bandwagon of, knows how to, in a sense, profit off of the very movement to dismantle it. And that's where we are. So it's that understanding of, am I like really doing something, or am I just adding to the problem and seeming like I'm doing something? Because it's tiring to be an ally. We understand that. It's tiring. This is not easy work, and it's not a fun thing to realize the world that you live in and the role that you play in perpetuating that violence. So trending and black lives, it doesn't feel... it doesn't feel quite honest to me. It doesn't feel genuine.
Shiba, is there anything you want to add to that?
I mean, I felt lots of things that you just said, Zama. Especially when talking about trending, Black Lives Matter wasn't like a movement that was new. Having done research on the Black Lives Matter movement that came about in 2012, the same way it came up, and lots of people went to the streets and people were claiming they were allies, the same timeline it went down, and the same thing is happening again. So also seeing that the duality of, okay, death has to be so outraging, and it can always be topped, and that's also something that I find so horrific. And also, like talking about the videos, like it's almost like pornographically consumed by people, especially by white people, and it's like, and that frustrates me definitely. And also, Yeah, I think that is also why the demonstrations, I was very pessimistic about them last year, because I was, why are you talking about this right now? It's not like this is new. It took it to be so vile, and it took it to be like videoed for you to believe it. But what does it say about your allyship when that's the ground of it? So it's already shaken. It shouldn't be standing on exactly that. And how can we believe that from that starting on?
I do think like, the more things seem to change, the more nothing change. The more, I don't want to say stays the same, the more nothing change, because it's performative attempting of change, I feel. And this is decades and hundreds of years of performative allyship. Because when I think of being an apartheid-born child, raised in this violent transition as well, I think of like, apartheid days, Europe was up in arms, America was up in arms, because the US, it was closer to the civil rights movement. I mean, even in Norway, you know, there was so much activism, and some of the South African leaders were in Norway. But at the end of the day, it's like, there's a picketing of the outrage that happens, the same with Israel as well, right? People picket and say, save Palestine, and then when they're done, they just put their posters down and they go on with their lives. So for me, it's just, it's also a waste of energy for us who you say that you're trying to be allies for, because you're also giving people false hope of change. And in that false hope, it's like, it's cruel, actually. It's very, very cruel. It's like promising a child ice cream every single day for the rest of their life and saying, I promise this time I can see the truck running, I will run after it. And you run very slow so you don't catch up to the truck. I don't know if that's a good metaphor.
I quickly wanted to add something with regards to trending allyship. When allyship, especially BLM, was trending, there was also equally anti-blackness, not just among white people, all people of color, was going really high because of the trending. Because I come from a South Asian background, Tamil background, Asians in general. So from the Asian community, there was a lot of hate as well, anti-blackness going really high, mentioning that we suffer racism too, we're not making too much drama, you know, those kind of nonsense. So I had to also personally look at my own anti-blackness in me and constantly correct myself. And that was definitely an eye-opening thing as well, and a learning, shameful eye-opening for me as well personally, and my own community and other POCs as well, where we started introspecting and looking at our own anti-blackness. Because I think all of us are kind of positioned in this indoctrinated hierarchy by whiteness, and me as a model minority who's never seen as a threat, exoticized definitely, but never seen as a threat, I have this huge privilege of never being seen as a danger, you know? And then comparing my pain, my kind of experience with someone else who's suffering even more, I just could not see the logic behind it. But then again, that kind of discussion never happens among POC, non-black minorities, non-white people, I mean people of color. It never happens in their communities or in their circles, never. They never confront the anti-blackness. And that was trending extremely high. And then the moment Asian Lives Matter started, then the trend kind of shifted. All the white people and everyone who was BLM, they moved to, oh no, Asian Lives Matter. And then suddenly Asian people like, oh my God, there are other black people who are also, you know, attacking us. And they were kind of promoted that as well, especially in America, where every video, everything that you see, it's some black person who has a mental disability, is mentally challenged, or sorry for using that word, has a mental illness, or somewhere is triggered, has attacked without any, you know,
full understanding. Proof.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Full understanding. Somewhere they were felt threatened. Predominantly, there were also women who attacked as well, but it was for other context. And then suddenly they galvanized it, especially the white media galvanized it, and make it into a black against Asian hate crime, that black people are hate, you know, and it's a only black issue. So I wanted to just point that out, and I'm sorry if it's...
I am so glad.
Because it's something that I wanted to stress on, that there is anti-blackness in the people of color community, and that needs to be addressed and needs to be worked on. And then we cannot call ourselves as allies, because I struggle with that term myself, working as an to be an ally, because I feel that I'm not putting in enough effort. And then this is something that I have to deal with, that when you're put in the middle, where you someone who struggle and you also someone who brings struggle to others.
You know? I'm also really glad that you said that, especially speaking to the fact that you understand that in the hierarchy of racism, you are less of a threat. And I want to speak to that, because there's so much that you're saying there in that sentence already. You're acknowledging the fact that black skin is considered a threat. Number
weaponized.
One.
Weaponized.
You're acknowledging that white supremacy is very good at divide and conquering. So suddenly we're fighting amongst each other as people of color when all of us are being subjugated under the same system. So it's just a matter of, and I try to be a compassionate person. So I don't want to say I understand, but I understand, because if I was a POC and I saw the system and I knew that aligning to whiteness protected me, and all that I needed to do was sell black people out as a human, I might do that. You know, I want to put myself in the shoes of people with more privilege than me. So I want to give humans the benefit of the doubt. But when we're speaking about allyship, those are the things that you have to be wary of, in that we are, and it can be race, it can be gender, it can be like it can be disability. We're all being divided amongst ourselves, because the biggest threat against white supremacy is unity. Unity of all races, of all genders, of all abilities. And when we, you know, keep playing into the dividing and the conquering, then white supremacy, you know, endures as it has for 500 years.
And I mean, look, the whole reason apartheid was even able to exist, it was a divide and conquer. It's the 1913 Act, where they literally threw people out of their homes, right? According to the paperback test, whoever could pass as white, it's the same history of the civil rights, right? But just like a more crueler one, more harsher one, which is also this thing of like so many people died on video during apartheid, and it was the same thing that keeps coming up. But what I wanted to say to you is thank you so much. Why? Because a lot of the times we're in white spaces and we can't have that conversation as people of color. I don't know how many times black people have been thrown under the bus by people of color.
It needs to be
done. First stop, like, people of color don't even think. There's not even a pause. It's like at any sign of whiteness, we are the first to go, time and time and time again, including that old Asian hate crime, where Asian people are also forgetting that black people were also following that movement, right? And I think this is good that we're having this conversation, because a lot of the times we're saying whiteness, 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 and we're forgetting that within ourselves we're not united. And the whole purpose of white supremacy is to derail us from the conversation of uniting, right? So we are constantly centralizing them, because if we centralize them, we lose the fight that we're supposed to be taking. Because imagine if people of color, the whole spectrum of POC, which for me, it's come to a point where I don't associate myself as a POC. I am blackity black, you know? Because the violence of POCs is really harsh to black people, and including black women. But if we were to come together as people of color, white supremacy is being destabilized in a way that it can never imagine, because its whole premises is to divide and conquer. That's why we have this human totem pole, this human social economical totem pole, because it has to compartmentalize all of us in order for the system to function. So
definitely,
thank you.
I definitely agree with you, and how you also recognized your own privilege of, you know, that's something that we need to do. I feel that every one of us as BIPOCs, we need to recognize everyone has some sort of privilege, and all of us have struggles. All of us have struggles, but we also have some assign privileges where we need to appreciate and then try to apply them to enable others who suffer. For example, for me, it's very important that I work around BIPOC, queer BIPOC, especially refugees. I work mostly with queer refugees, people who come from the Middle East and from Africa and from Asia. And it's very important that I use my migration and my education, that privilege what I have and knowledge, to kind of work towards and make it a better place for them, and also try to educate white people, but that's something that will come to it later. How do we educate white people? But this is very important, this conversation, what you said, it's something that I've personally experienced as well, where I tried to kind of stop it, but I was helpless, because you are right, it's again, in the end, black people are the ones who first to go, because they are constantly, I mean, white people consider us as more, people who better. Are not black as better and like, you know, less threatening, that approachable, you know, that we are approachable. And that kind of cancels a lot of opportunities, And this privilege of my minority privilege, I need to acknowledge. And it took me a lot of time, and I acknowledged it after a lot of struggle, but I acknowledge it, and I think many of them need to do it, and it'll make it much easier. I'm sorry, I'm still struggling with the whole theme, because thank you so much for letting me speak about that. It's very important that we speak about it, yes.
Thank you for speaking about it. I feel like a lot of the times we are in spaces where it's not safe for us to have these conversations. And I'm glad that we could create a safety space that these conversations could happen. They're really important, and if we're gonna move forward, it can't just be black, white. There's those nuances that keep making sure that the progress that we need to happen is not happening.
Yes.
We're not looking at the nuances, right? Because there's a structure that we need to follow that's being pinned against each other. But Shiva, you've been quiet there.
Yeah, I was listening because it was so interesting, but also because I had lots of thought about exactly that, because I think I've been in several situations as well where we were in a group of BIPOC people and like also people of color, and talking about racism, and I hear it and I listen, and I don't see those nuances, what you're talking about, and always having to bring these topics in these conversations, like anti-blackness, let's look at that, for example, as perspective and a reality that we need to look at, and also, and when it comes to blackness, everybody always wants to separate themselves from it, and in so many different ways, and it's so layered and it's so complicated, and also looking at, and that's why I think blackness, anti-blackness is a good word, because we, and I also fail to look at racism as something, like racism, anti-blackness especially, as something of color, and of color meaning especially shades, and meaning the proximity to whiteness, and all these ways it functions and how it works, and these conversations are not being had because people don't want to lose their experiences of experiencing racism. And I think in the fear of losing that, but I experience racism too, people say, but we are all in the same boat, which is, that's totally problematic, and it hurts so much. And why can't we have this conversation where we acknowledge our privilege and move forward together and learn? But yeah, that's all my thoughts.
You had a word for it this morning.
What?
This, my finger hurts, so does mine. Like if I say that, like, I have this experience, whiteness has a tendency to say, well, we all have that experience, this nullifying or competitive. There was a word you...
Neutralize the conversation?
I would say erasure?
No, you had a different word for it.
Mayonnaising it. Mayonnaise on your tongue. But I agree with that point as well, you know. I really have to agree with it, that kind of generalizing the struggle. I totally agree, because that's something that I talk among other people of color, that when someone else talks about their struggle, just do not say that, oh my God, I've experienced that too. Just listen. Shut up and listen, please, shut up and listen. just don't generalize your struggle with others. It's completely different. That's all I wanted to say, and I agree completely with that. It's very common in the German context. Mm.
And in the Norwegian context as well, that I found that I struggled a lot, because all you would say is, I've had this experience. And, you know, when, especially when you talk to someone who's not fully within your experience, it's always they're trying to find a connection of their own experience, and it's not coming in from a good place necessarily. It's coming from comparison, like not comparison, but like I would say nullifying, like when you void something, right? So it's like this competition, not even a competition, it's just like
it's that thing where the experience you're trying to impart on someone with perhaps more privilege than you is so distant from their experience that they try to find something that they think is comparable to your experience. And when they find that thing and they sort of sit on it and mull it over, to them they're like, oh, well, then it's not that bad. Because obviously, like you said, everyone has struggles. So if it's like someone saying that if you grew up poor, then you understand what it means to be black. No.
Which is a very common comparison, right? Because poverty is equal to black.
And
I don't come from poverty.
Thank you.
And
the thing is,
I can't relate, you know? So, so poverty is not equal to blackness, but like, I think it comes with these posters that we see of little African people or little children in Africa, and there's always a goddamn fly. I swear to God, like somebody just comes with a pin and just places it there and says, action, you know? Because it's all...
Those are disgusting.
They're so disgusting.
They're even in bathrooms.
Listen, and that for $1 a day, you can save a starving African child.
Instead of them just stop looting our continent so that we can self-sustain ourselves.
Please, can I speak to that? Please, can I speak to that?
Go ahead. But we're going to have to open up soon. This is your last conclusion.
No problem, no problem. I'll try to be fast. When we speak to anti-blackness, which is global, and how it rests on the devaluing of the African continent, I feel that when we sit here and we speak about soft utopias, we need to be very honest about what is keeping us from this utopia where everyone across the board is protected and loved and does not have to fight for their right to survive or to live, essentially. And I say that because white capitalist supremacy, the foundation of it is the devaluing of the black body and the black continent. In a capitalist sense, it is devaluing of the black continent because it has one of the most resource-rich continent on the world. And if you're devaluing what is coming out of that continent, then it's cheap to, you know, make an iPhone. But if the African continent were actually given its value, iPhones would be like, I don't know, 50,000 pounds. And that can't happen. So it's also understanding that even me with an iPhone being a South African, I'm also playing into this very same game of devaluing my continent for its resources and also the devaluing of its people. Because white capitalism, white supremacy, the whole shenanigan, it is the taking of from one group of people to give to others to hoard, because there's enough for everyone at the end of the day. But if the entire world, from Asia to South America, understands that the black body is worthless and you can get everybody in on that, then capitalism, white supremacy can thrive, because that's just an innate belief that people aren't asking and questioning in themselves. It's what they've learned and they just move with it.
And also to hold on to that one is, I know it's a bit of a derail, but this plays into why South Africa is being punished or Southern Africa is being punished. It's the same thing, because South Africa is asking for the patent. South Africa is so powerful that it is also able to work through Africa. If we get that patent, we can develop the anti-vaccines, and they can't have us self-sustaining. So we're being punished for not knowing our place, basically. It's a reiteration of geopolitics to say, you need to stay where you are, and because you talk too much with your fancy scientists, we're going to punish you. Because there's no logic to that, where the stamp of the first mutated virus is in Europe,
yeah.
a month before, right? So I just wanted to add that it plays into this, and as a South African, I know I'm recently being discriminated against.
They brought all the diseases.
Right?
They brought all the diseases, everything that I'm vaccinated, I need to be vaccinated to be here. They brought those shit with their rats and all their nastiness, unwashed feet and okay. whatever. I'm stopping there.
I did want to draw on one point. Wait, let me get it again.
You can take it.
I wanted to come back to performative allyship again because... I'm not sure if Western states, white states, are even like trying to be performative allies, but I did want to speak about white saviorism because that it comes to it. Because you need Africa, you need the black body to be weak, to be perceived at least at that, to be a white savior. So everything that keeps you being the white savior is also initially it's part of white supremacy, but also plays into the hand of not just like capitalistically speaking being on top, but also still being like having the moral high ground as well, which is so much part of this whole thing.
And this is why even when I move within theaters or establishments or institution, even though it's a collaborative process, I'm always finding myself, they treat me like they're doing me a favor. As if who I am is not arriving ready and contributing on an equal footing. It's always, you always get that, we're kind of doing you a favor by accommodating you, and I move a lot in white spaces, and that's not something that I just wanted, it just somehow happened. But because I move so much in white spaces, it's always like this fight between, you must remember you're the token black, and the token diversity card is us doing you a favor. And when I retaliate to that and say, no, that's not who I am, then I'm difficult, I'm angry, I'm this, I'm emotional, I'm irrational, all the kind of bullshit that they put on you, again, to reiterate the narratives so that they can keep you in your place. Last thing, and then we're opening it up. So if anybody has a question in the meanwhile, please just contextualize it. We're going to open it up after someone's last comment.
Yeah, I want to speak to your experience as an artist because we are in these spaces that are safe, per se. We have these festivals that are created to, you know, create safe spaces. But even within such organizations, who are working towards a soft utopia? How are you also still failing the people that you're fighting for within your organization? How are you perpetrating the very same trauma within how you work in your organization? And even then, it's like, this is great, Nordbrun is amazing, and it's lovely to see all the people in this room, but I'm also just also so very aware of how wide the room is and how bright on the stage is. So it's this thing of like, even within Hamburg, is this organization reaching out to the people that it is trying to fight for and work for? Is it truly, is it doing the work within that it is purporting to do without? And I think everyone, and that's why the rules of engagement is challenged with care. Everybody also needs to challenge themselves in terms of, yes, you are trying to do the work and you are trying to create spaces, but also where are you perpetuating the same violence to, say, performers who are outspoken and unapologetic, like Duduzile. And I think that's also very important because even it all leads to intention, and that's always the justification of like, oh, well, I mean, well, my intentions were good. Intention does not negate harm. And once we start to remember that, then we can really start to look at ourselves honestly and our actions, even in spaces we believe to be safe.
That's almost like an ending, but we still have time. Yeah, I know it's a lot to swallow for everyone. And also for us, we're also negotiating with being able to say some of the things that we want to say, because it is things that sit with us and things that we have to go through, and on a daily basis we're exhausted. And yeah, so I wanted to know if I'm going to open it up to you guys. And remember, this is a safe space for all of us. And we're all just like figuring it out. And so if there's any questions, please, you can raise your hand. Yes. Can somebody give her a mic, please? Thank you.
Hi, hello.
Hello.
I'm French, so I'm going to try to be good with my English. Be kind. So I'm a white woman. I'm a white disabled woman. And I'm aware of my privilege of being white. I'm coming from France. And in France, we have this whole idea of universalism. So it's liberté, fraternité, égalité. Basically, we are all equal. Mm-hmm. We are all French before being black, disabled, Asian, whatever. Mm-hmm. We are French. I've been raised in that, and I've been trying to deconstruct myself for the past maybe 3-4 years. And I just wanted to say thank you for this discussion. And I think, yes, it's a safe space, but I think it's a very brave space today. So just thank you. And I was wondering, because France is about universalism, how is it in Germany? Like, how does Germany see like multiculturalism and stuff like that?
I will extend your question to also Zama, like, how is it in the UK as well? So, yeah.
I think, I mean, obviously we can speak about nations and people's experience within nations, but something that is, that stands everywhere, it doesn't matter what nationality you have, first you are black. The first thing people perceive of you is that you're black. So even as a biracial and light-skinned black person, I'm differently read than a person who has two black parents or who's darker skinned. So my experience is a very different one, but people are not being read as German. That's it. We are being spoken to as if we don't speak German. We are, we're just not read as German. So that's, but I think that's an experience that we'll have anywhere we'll go in Europe and even like UK maybe, I'm not sure. But in lots of spaces that are just white, we all won't be accepted as a person who has grown up and lived here always.
Germans, may I answer to that?
Yes, please.
Because Germans have this very strong feeling of ethnicity and nationality being clubbed together. So they have this thing called Volkszugehörigkeit. So it's like people belonging to this particular thing, community. It's very strong. It's not just from the Nazi time, it's way before, it goes like way before. So if you're German, you need to be white and you need to belong to that, and then you're accepted as German. And if you are not, they will say something called, they love using this Migrationshintergrund, meaning that you have a migration background, so you'll never be accepted as German, never. So they will always, and people always, even if it's not bad intentioned, they will subconsciously or consciously, they will kind of discriminate you. For example, people, when they see me, they always start speaking in English. Oh. I speak German, but still they speak only in English with me. It's kind of like, you know, you don't belong with us, you know. Oh. I'll still speak in English with you and push you away. Oh. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
You know, you'll be fluent in the language, but still, they'll be like, you know, hi, how are you? And I'm like, start in German. They'll be like, you know, sometimes respond only in English. Yeah. And so, you know, it's kind of like, that's how they are. Yeah. So it's quite, that's why I had to laugh my ass off when Germany was mentioned. Yeah. So, yeah.
I feel like there's a duality to that as well. Like, there's those who, th- those who are from certain European countries, born, bred, speak the language, you get this kind of discrimination. And then there's the us who's newly into the diaspora. When I speak English, I'm spoken to back in German, and very aggressively so, or I'm spoken to back in Norwegian, very aggressively so. I sit in a board, a theater board, and in my first meeting, one of the board members said to me, how long have you been in Norway? So I told her, and she said, yeah, but why don't you speak the language? Excuse me? You knew very well when I came into the board that I speak English. And she said, yeah, well, don't you think it's a bit, inconsiderate, or like, not inconsiderate, but like, you know when you disturb people somehow, like for other people who speak Norwegian. So I find it very interesting that there's these dualities. I know that I've heard the story of like people who are born there, the minute they speak the language that is of the land, they're met with this English, and then if you're not born there and you speak English, you're met with the language. And I get people repeat things to me, like, and I'm like, I said it yesterday, I don't know if you speak German to me 4 or 5 times saying the same word that I'm going to actually hear you. But I just feel like you can never win with whiteness.
Yep. Agreed.
And I think speaking to that, I want everyone, Germans, French people, whomever, basically countries that still had the freedom and power to preserve their languages, unlike a lot of like African countries, I would like people to understand that English is not my first language. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. English is a language that I was taught. Mm-hmm. South Africa was colonized. Mm-hmm. Like, it's unfortunately, you can blame the UK. That English is the universal language. Mm. It is not me. So when I'm coming and speaking to you in English and I'm being met in German because I don't know the language, I'm not coming here to disrespect your language. I am literally trying to meet you halfway because I can speak Xhosa and you can speak German and we can just have a whole day of like not understanding what we're each other saying. But the thing is, like, we all know a little bit of English. So if someone's coming to you, speaking English, especially being part of the diaspora, or if they're an immigrant or a diplomat, depending on the color of their skin, it's that understanding that this person, and even if they speak poor English, they are trying to meet you halfway. It is not because they don't disrespect your language. They just don't know it. Just like Ginger said yesterday, she knows 11 different languages. And if, like, maybe she doesn't have space for another one right now, considering she doesn't live in Germany, and she can't exactly pick up the language right there. So it is uncomfortable when we come in, and I'm trying to meet you halfway speaking English, and suddenly it's an affront. And I've experienced it a lot in France. Yes, not to.
Yeah, you get caught up in their war, these language wars that have nothing to do with you.
Because suddenly, like, everyone who speaks English is on behalf of the English. And listen, I live in London, but I still say fuck the monarchy. So it's, you know, let's meet each other halfway, you know?
I want to open it up again. Does anybody else have a question, a comment?
I just wanted to say, like, that we have 10 minutes left. Sorry.
Yes, I'm on it. Okay. I'm on it. Yeah. Question, comments, realizations? No? There we go.
Hi. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
Hello, everybody. I'm Stefan. Thank you very much for your interesting conversation. I'm just thinking about something. I don't know if I have a clear question formulated.
That's okay.
I work with performance and as a performer and as an actor, and I'm from Sweden. A couple of years ago, I worked in a performance called Vahak that was dealing with Sweden's colonization of in Sápmi, and like, yeah, and the domestic colonization within Sweden. And I'm not Sami, and it was like a mixed ensemble of a couple of Sami persons. And
I just want you, I know what the Sami people are, but I just want you to explain quickly who Sami is, just for the room to catch up.
Okay, yeah, it's the indigenous people in Scandinavia and Finland and Russia.
Okay.
So they, yeah, across nations. And I was invited to perform in this performance, and then I also questioned it a lot, like, why should I, that are not Sami, be in this performance and tour with it? And then it also became, after a while, when I started working with it, it became extremely important that we were a mixed ensemble. And also talking about like being a white body, like I realize my position as someone that people are used to listen to when I'm on stage, like a white male body, and me also being there in a performance work like visibilizing the struggles of the Samis. So but it became like this very present question for me, also like of allyship as a performer, and like when is it, I don't know the question now, like, but when is it right to do that, like, and when is it not, like, to, because I'm also taking up space from someone else, like a potentially another Sami performer also talking about the struggles, like, but for us an ensemble, in our work, it became super important that we were mixed and that it was not only Sami people talking about their struggles and the visibility within like Sweden. Yeah, if you have any thoughts about this, it would be interesting.
I have one question. Did you play the colonizer, or did you play, you know, the indigenous person? That is the question.
No, it was not like structured with roles. It was just stories, and I was not like in the performance. I was not positioned as a Sami person, and I was not positioned as a non-Sami person. We had like shared texts and like.
I think for me, there's also, I think it's, your question needs a little bit more time to break down, because for me, there's the element of indigenous Sami, which have mixed so much with the rest of Scandinavia, right? And a lot of people still have a pure Sami background, but a lot of people also have mixed with other Scandinavians or Russian people. And there's, I guess there's a racial ambiguity, but there's also like a violent past that Scandinavia gives to Sami, but somehow it's a different history than ours, because that history has kind of like come together in a way. And, you know, like these countries have given Sami people their own reign, their own governances. They are also on the higher level in terms of the human, social, economical totem pole within Scandinavia. They have certain privileges, of course, and certain disadvantages. So I think, like, for me, I'm not sure if I can fully answer that, because then it's, they have more proximity to whiteness than a person like me who's really at the bottom, right? But I think it can also boil down to everybody who you work with and who you're trying to be an ally with, you also have to listen to what they have to say. Because I think if you can open up a space of how you guys work together, it has to be a safe enough space for them to also say how they need to say. I think there, I don't want to say all black and brown people don't want to collaborate. I know there are people who want to collaborate, but there has to be a conversation. I don't really necessarily, I don't have the answer for now, but I do know that when you walk into a room, just be aware of your privilege, you know, like in that questioning is the failing.
You actually answered exactly what I wanted to say.
Okay.
Thank you very much for
that. Thank you.
I also wanted to add, I mean, with the history, and I'm going to do it very shortly, with the history of menstrual series where people were putting paint on their face and acting as if they were black people or as if they...
Blackface.
Blackface. But acting as if they... to the stereotypes that they perceived of black people, and also cross-dressing where people would dress up and then pretend to be trans. All these kinds of histories are in performance, in theater, in TV, film, musicals, all these kinds of things. And I think you need to be aware of these structures, how they still today persist. And they don't persist just in like big forms and big productions, but they also exist on social media platforms, on TikTok, where people do the cross-dressing as well, people do the black-facing as well. And it's still ongoing. And I think it's important to like know about these histories and then in try to reflect in how much sense it makes to portray a person that can just portray themselves. And also Peaky Blinders, for example, they were playing Roma and Sinti people, and he explained, one of the main actors, how he went into villages where Roma and Sinti people were living, and just to understand how they were living, and then to properly act it out. And I was thinking, like, it doesn't make sense to me. Just get a person who really has the background. So that will at least my take on it.
It's that self-awareness of allyship.
I guess that's the overall thread that's been popping up throughout the whole conversation, is self-awareness, right? We have run out of time. And this is an ongoing conversation that I hope you all continue to take to your relative spaces. But we are having a different conversation, and you would be having a different conversation. So I hope you also take this conversation and pass it on. And I want to reiterate that it is not our job to decolonize. This is me. I know there are people who feel it is their job. It is the job of the colonizer to decolonize. So I think I want to reiterate that, because a lot of the time it's placed on those who have been colonized and suppressed to do the work for those who have colonized, and it's taxing, and we're tired. And so you do the work and then come back to us and we negotiate, because we're going on holiday.
But keep bringing the money.
Yeah.
Yes.
So we can go on holiday, right?
Yes.
But thank you very much. Thank you for sitting with us, being with us. Thank you so, so much for sharing.
Thank you.
I mean, I had
thank
to just
you.
Like thank drop you. This. I was like, what? This is a whole conversation. It's been lovely seeing your bright, colorful faces. Chocolatiers, as we are. And thank you to the audience and everybody else who's watching from the other side. Have a good night, and
yes,
we release
you.
Them.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Dudu.
Thank you.
And I think Melanie wants to announce something. Have a good night, and thank you, everyone.